Welcome back, learners. Let us continue with our activity on how to answer questions. Let us continue with how to answer question two, of which is your animal nutrition that only carries 35 marks. Now, let us go to our next question. Now, 1.3. Name two types of microorganisms that are found in the stomach areas of the ruminant. Animal. Specifically, diagram 3. Your answer should be bacteria or protozoa or fungi. So the question says you need to name two types. So we need two answers, right? So you can just write bacteria or protozoa, bacteria or fungi, protozoa or fungi for 2 marks. So you are not expected to write all the answers because number 3, it won't be marked. So it will be like you are wasting your time and energy. So every time when they are requesting you to give 2 answers, you must provide 2 answers. Remember, you must follow instructions at all times, right? And then also when it comes to this question, 1.3, you are not expected to write cellulitic bacteria, amylolytic bacteria, proteolytic bacteria. No. But you write bacteria, protozoa, or fungi because these are examples of microorganisms. And always remember that they are beneficial. Write 1.4. State 2 conditions that exist in the stomach that provide the ideal living conditions for the microorganisms in the stomach of this ruminant animal in diagram 3. Now, you have already learned beginning of this year, that ruminants and microorganisms, they have a relationship that is symbiotic, meaning ruminants benefit from microorganisms, and then microorganisms also benefit from ruminants. And again, for these microorganisms to function, they need a specific environment. They work under a specific environment. They have conditions. And for these conditions, number 1, you need to write warm temperature that ranges from 37 to 40 degrees Celsius. Number 2, anaerobic environment, or you can just say an environment that is without oxygen. Right? Number 3, a slightly acidic environment with a pH of 6.5. Sufficient nitrogen. These microorganisms, they also require nitrogen. They are organisms at the end of the day, right? Lastly, you can just write easily digestible carbohydrates. So these are the conditions. This is the environment needed by the microorganisms so they can digest nutrients. Right, now let us continue. Now, after understanding the different types of farm animals and their digestive system, on how you identify, how you differentiate, understand that there are different types of digestion. Digestion being the breaking down of food from large to smaller particles. Now, there are 3 types of digestion: mechanical digestion, chemical digestion, as well as the microbial digestion. You need to understand that. Where does mechanical digestion take place in the digestive system? Where does chemical digestion take place? Where does microbial digestion take place? Now, firstly, mechanical digestion is facilitated by teeth as well as the muscles. So where there are teeth, where there are muscles, you can find your mechanical digestion. Now, let us make an example using the pig or the digestive system of a pig. Now, the digestive system of a pig, number 1, in the mouth, we have teeth. Meaning, since there are teeth, there is a mechanical digestion. In the stomach, there are muscles. There is a mechanical digestion. Small intestines, there are muscles. There is a mechanical digestion. Now, chemical digestion. Type of digestion facilitated by enzymes. So every time where you have enzymes in the digestive system, you will find, or chemical digestion will take place, or okay, right? Using the pig digestive system again, the pig has an enzyme known as amylase in the mouth. Now, if they were to ask you, where does the mechanical digestion takes place in the mouth of pigs? Yes, it does. Why? Because there is an enzyme called amylase that is available, secreted by the saliva, right, in the digestive system of a pig. Right, moving to the simple stomach, we have pepsin as well as renin. Obviously, we have the chemical digestion in the stomach. Small intestines, you have different enzymes secreted by different glands, heaps of liver again. The pancreas, right, where you will find lipase, where you will find amylase, where you will find sucrase, maltase, lactase. There are different trypsinogen or trypsin, chymotrypsinogen. So where you find the enzymes, chemical digestion does take place. And then number three, microbial digestion. It is facilitated by microorganisms. So to each and every organ where you have microbes or microorganisms, you will find microbial digestion, also referred to as fermentation. And also, when it comes to digestion, you need also, in your question too, to understand the different processes of breaking down food, or different processes of digestion, like such as ingestion, digestion, absorption, assimilation, as well as ejection. Ingestion, the process of taking in food. Digestion, the process of breaking down food. Absorption, nutrients move from the small intestines into the blood. Assimilation, nutrients move from the blood to the body cells or to all body cells. Ejection, nutrients are being excreted. They are being taken out through the anus, meaning these nutrients are not digested. They never undergo the process of digestion. So you need to understand these processes of digestion, and you should be able to identify them. Right. And also, understand the components of food. Remember what we said. The different types of animals, they digest different types of food or nutrients. Now, each and every feed digested by the animal, it has got two components, whether it is a roughage or it is a concentrate. It has two components, and the two components making up the feed will be, number one, moisture content, number two, the dry matter, right? Moisture content, we speak of water, and then the dry matter, we speak of the nutrients contained by the feed. Anything that is dry, the nutrients contained by the feed. Now, when it comes to the components of feed, number one, understand the functions of water. Water, as it plays a role in the digestion process. Not as it plays a role in reproduction or production. Remember, this is the breaking down of nutrients. So we need the functions of water as it plays the role when it comes to digestion, of which is the breaking down of food. It acts as a solvent, right? It moistens and softens food. We know that. It assists in the breaking down of nutrients. It assists in excretion or ejection, assists during absorption. Right? So those are the answers you should provide for the exam. Not the answer as to say it assists during reproduction. Right? It acts as a shock absorber. No. You are not expected to write that, because that answer is for reproduction. That function of water, it is water playing a role during reproduction. Here we are dealing with the breaking down of nutrients. Right. Now, secondly, dry matter. Your dry matter in the exam, of which is the nutrients, are divided into two. One part of the nutrients are organic, some are inorganic. Inorganic nutrients being the minerals. Organic nutrients being your fats, your proteins, your carbohydrates, as well as the vitamins. So you should be able to identify organic nutrients and identify inorganic nutrients. And when it comes to these nutrients, you should be able to provide the functions, the nutrient deficiency symptoms. To each and every nutrient, provide the function as well as the nutrient deficiency. Right, let's just look at protein, carbohydrates, as well as fats. There you should know the building blocks of each nutrient. Like, for instance, protein is made up of amino acids. Fats made up of volatile fatty acid as well as glycerol. Carbohydrates made up of sugars, or we can just sugars or starch, right? So you need to understand the building blocks as well as the functions. The building blocks as well as the functions. But when it comes to the vitamins and the minerals, now let's start with the vitamins. You should understand that in the exam, vitamins are divided into two. We have vitamins that are fat soluble, meaning they are soluble in fats, they dissolve in fats, being A, D, E, and K. And for the exam, this is what you should prepare. Firstly, the function of each vitamin or vitamin and the nutrient deficiency. What are the symptoms shown by an animal with a shortage of fat-soluble vitamin or a shortage of vitamin A or D or E or K? We are looking for the symptoms. A, the symptom of vitamin A, night blindness. Vitamin D, osteomalacia. Rickets. Vitamin D, blood. Vitamin D, muscular dystrophy. Vitamin K, blood clotting, right? Or a reduced blood clotting, excessive bleeding. So those are the symptoms we are looking for. Those are the key symptoms we are looking for. Right. Number two, vitamins. We have vitamins that are water soluble. They dissolve in water, being vitamin B1, B2, B6, and B12. And again, when it comes to these, understand the function of each vitamin and the nutrient deficiency symptom. Curled toe paralysis in chickens. You need to take note of the key symptoms. And then minerals are also divided into two. You need to understand that, because in the exam, you will be provided with like the diagrams. Let's just say the minerals being divided into two. So you should be able to provide an answer or identify that this mineral is a macro, this one is a micro, be able to give functions, be able to give nutrient deficiencies or nutrient deficiency symptoms. Now, minerals, macro minerals, and micro minerals. Macro minerals are needed by animals in large quantities. Micro, trace minerals, needed by animals in smaller quantities. Macro being your phosphorus, your potassium, your sodium, your chlorine, your magnesium, and sulfur, right? From macro minerals, functions, deficiency, symptoms. Phosphorus, deficiency symptoms, pica. Potassium, SSO. You need potassium, sodium, chlorine. They play a role when it comes to osmotic pressure. Those are the symptoms, those are the functions you need to understand by, from each of the minerals. Right, magnesium. You need to understand the nutrient deficiency of magnesium. Right, and then microelements being iron, copper, cobalt, selenium, zinc, right, Zn, zinc, iodine, as well as the manganese. Functions, nutrient deficiency, symptoms. Iron, anemia. How do you know if your animal is suffering from a nutrient deficiency of a nutrient deficiency or an iron deficiency? Anemia, the main symptom. Paleness, lack of appetite. So those are the answers you should provide, right? And then iodine, goitre, nutrient deficiency symptom, and enlarged thyroid gland, right? So these are the things you should be able to write in the exam. You should know the nutrient deficiency symptoms, the key nutrient deficiency symptoms of each and every mineral or vitamin. Now, as much as we have the feed, there is different components. You should understand that different types of farm animals, they digest feed differently, and they consume different types of feed. Now, there are two types of feed consumed by the farm animals. Number one, concentrate. Number two, roughages. So if you have a diagram, or they can just give you pictures, right, of each a feed, you should be able to identify, or you should be able to say or to write whether or to identify whether this feed is a concentrate or this feed is a roughage. When we speak of roughage, we speak of grass, but you are not expected to write grass. But just think of grass, a grass. The type of animal that feed primarily or mainly on grass, it is the ruminants. Why the ruminants? They secrete microorganisms, or a large number of microorganisms. So those are the answers that you should provide in the exam. You should be able to identify the concentrate. Farm animals that feed mainly on concentrates are non-ruminant. Why? Because they do not secrete microorganisms in the stomach or in their simple stomach. So those are the things you should be working with. And then secondly, you should be able to differentiate between the concentrates and the roughages in terms of the volume, the nutritional value, the price, the digestibility, right? Roughages, they are less digestible, while concentrates are highly digestible. Why roughages are less digestible? They contain more of crude fiber, and crude fiber being cellulose, hemicellulose, and lignin. Any feed that is rich in crude fiber, or that has more of crude fiber, is less digestible. So between the two feeds, roughages are less digestible because they have more of crude fiber, and they have less or low nutritional value. And their digestible, or their digestion, is less than 60%. While concentrate is more than 50%, they are highly digestible. when it comes to being cheap and expensive, concentrate will be expensive. Why? They have a high nutritional value. They are highly digestible. Roughages are cheap. They are less digestible. They have a low nutritional value. And when it comes to the volume, roughages, they are bulky, meaning they have a high volume, while roughages have a low volume. I hope you understand that. So these are the differences you should be able to provide to concentrate as well as the roughages. And also, you should be able to understand the functions of each feed. Like, for instance, why are concentrates important? Necessary for production, necessary for reproduction, necessary for growth. Why? Because they are highly digestible and they have a high nutritional value. Functions of roughages: prevent bloating, responsible for rumen development. They provide bulkiness. Right. And also, when it comes to these different types of feed, understand that there are feed, or there is a feed that is protein rich, a feed that is energy rich. Let's just make an example using concentrates. There are concentrates that are energy rich. There are concentrates that are protein rich. Roughages. There are roughages that are protein rich. There are roughages that are energy rich. And also, when it comes to roughages, you need to know that some roughages are dry, some roughages are succulent. A dry roughage, it has low moisture content. A succulent roughage, it has high moisture content. So in the exam, you should be able, number one, to identify the type of feed, and also to say whether the feed is protein rich or energy rich. Right. And then also the supplements. What happens when an animal is suffering from a nutrient deficiency? We supplement. There are different supplements, right? And also, what are supplements? Substances added to correct the nutrient deficiency or to improve the nutritional value. Nutrients that are supplemented, right? Then we need to supplement, especially on farm animals. Minerals. Right? Minerals, vitamins or vitamins, hormones, proteins, antibiotics, as well as tranquilizers. Now, how do we supplement minerals? Using mineral leak that is to be provided during the dry season, of which is winter, also to stimulate water consumption. Right? Mineral leak, through injection, we can mix with water. We can use the dosing gun, right? Proteins provide urea as well as the biuret. So between the two, you should be able to identify the safe protein supplement, of which is the biuret. Why? It is less soluble. Urea is not considered as being safe because it is highly soluble, meaning it may cause urea poisoning. Biuret being safe, it will be more expensive. Urea being unsafe, it will be cheaper than the biuret. But all in all, we are supplementing protein, right? Any feed that is in short of protein, we provide urea or biuret, non-protein nitrogen, and we give it to the ruminants. Why? Because they have microorganisms, they have the ability to synthesize amino acid. Right? Hormones, we also supplement hormones. Antibiotics, we supplement antibiotics. If the farm animals has a weak immune system or the antibodies are no longer functional, so we can provide antibiotics that will help to fight microorganisms, right? The last one would be tranquilizers. chemicals used or substances used to provide animals so they can be calm. Remember, we are running an enterprise, so we want our animals to produce more, meaning they shouldn't be more active. They should be calm. So most energy can go towards production, reproduction, as well as growth. Now, let us look at our next activity on how we can answer the different types of feed as well as the supplements. Now, the following feeds are available to a farm: yellow maize meal, oat straw, silage, lucerne, peanut oil cake meal, bone meal. Complete the schematic representation below by including the appropriate example of a feed from the list above in each case. For 5 marks. Now, we said different types of feed. A concentrate. We have energy-rich concentrate, protein-rich concentrate. Roughage. We have dry roughages, succulent roughages, and also roughages. There are those that are energy-rich and those that are protein-rich. Now, for 2.3.1. Now, as you can see, it is a roughage and it is succulent, right? 2.3.1, we have a silage. Silage is a succulent roughage. It has more moisture content. That is why it is correct and it fits for this answer or description or subdivision. 2.3.2. Right, we have a concentrate, and this concentrate is energy rich, it has more carbohydrates. Right, the answer will be your yellow maize meal, right? Because maize meal is energy rich, right? 2.3.3, right? A concentrate that is protein rich and is of bland origin. The correct answer will be peanut oil cake meal, right? 2.3.4, a roughage that is dry and high in protein will be your lucerne. Lucerne is protein rich and it is a dry roughage. 2.3.5, right? It is a roughage. It is a roughage. It is dry and it has low in protein. Your answer for that question will be oat straw. So we need to correct that. Oat straw, not meal, but straw. Because the moment we say meal, it is no longer a roughage, but a concentrate. So oat straw, the correct answer is oat straw, not meal. Remember, it is a roughage that is bulky and less digestible. And also, to be able to differentiate between concentrates and roughages, right? When they say a maize meal, that is a concentrate. But the moment they say a maize straw, a maize stalk, a maize plant, that is no longer a concentrate, but a roughage. They are speaking about the plant or a straw or a stalk that carries the maize. So it is a roughage. Now, let us move to the calculations. Now, before we even reach the calculations, understand that there is a way that is used, or a method used, to calculate the quality of protein in a feed. And it is referred to as the biological value. Now, biological value is defined as the measure of the quality of protein in a feed, right? Quality of protein is measured in two ways: through essential amino acid index, as well as the ideal protein. Essential amino acid index, we are using egg as an example, as egg contains more of protein than other feed. Right, produce or than other products. Now we use egg protein as a reference. Now, when a feed has a high biological value. It simply tells us that the feed is rich in protein. But when it has a low biological value, that feed is not rich in protein. It has low protein. The higher the biological value, the higher the protein. Now, on the second method being ideal protein, we use lysine as a reference. Lysine as a reference. As to say, if a feed has the presence of lysine, all other nutrients or all other amino acids will be synthesized. But if there is no lysine as a reference, no amino acid or no essential amino acid will be synthesized, or no amino acid will be digested or be synthesized, if I can put it that way. Remember, we have two amino acids, essential amino acids and non-essential amino acids. Essential amino acid has to be consumed through the food. They need to be digested. For animal to have those nutrients, they need to digest feed. This is how they obtain amino acid or essential amino acid. So we use these two methods to measure the quality of protein in a feed. Essential amino acid index using the egg protein, and the ideal protein using the lysine as a reference. Now, for the exam or for question two, you're also expected to calculate different nutrients, or to calculate whether different nutrients or different feeds or different whatever. But you must calculate. When it comes to question two, there are calculations. Number one, digestible or digestibility coefficient, energy values, nutritive ratio, pacing square, as well as the fodder flow program. So there are five calculations in question two. And three or four of these calculations will be there, or three of these will be there. Now, let's start with the digestibility coefficient. We look at the amount of nutrients digested and absorbed by the animal. Remember, when we were looking at the components of feed, we said a normal feed should have a moisture content as well as the dry matter, and the dry matter being nutrients. And nutrients are the ones digested in the digestive system. Meaning, when calculating digestibility coefficient, at all times, you must exclude the moisture content, because we do not digest, or animals do not digest water, but they digest nutrients. And nutrients, they form part of dry matter. Not moisture content, but dry matter. So to each and every feed that has a moisture content, you need to exclude the moisture content and be left with the dry matter, of which is the only component that has or contains the nutrients. Now, before you even attempt answering the question, you already have two marks. One for a formula, another one for a unit. By just writing, digestibility coefficient is equals to dry matter intake minus dry matter excreted divided by dry matter intake multiplied by 100. Not 100%, 100. You already have a mark for just writing a formula. So you can't be losing these marks. These are hanging fruits. You should be able to obtain the two marks, right? And then after, or before even calculating, you must understand that for you to substitute, you only substitute the kgs. Meaning your substitutions should be in kgs, not in percentages, but in kgs. If you are given or provided with a dry matter that is in percentages, you must convert it to kgs, because we only substitute kgs in the digestibility coefficient. But the answer will be in percentages. Why? Because mild digestibility coefficient is measured in percentages. Now, let us look at this activity based on the digestibility coefficient. The following information was used during a digestibility trial conducted on a group of ruminant farm animals. Dry material of the feed, 88%. Already, you need to convert that 88% of the feed to kgs. Dry matter content of the manure that was taken out, 77%. You need to convert that 77% and into kgs so you can substitute in the formula. Right, manure that was excreted, 3.5. Average feed intake, that is 10 kg. So basically, this animal consumed 10 kg of feed, and the feed or the dry matter that was digested is about 88%. And it also excreted manure of 3.5, and 77% of this manure was dry matter, or it was dry. Now, you need to convert. How do you convert? Right, firstly, you need to convert the dry matter. You will say dry matter intake is equals to 88 divided by 100 multiplied by 10 is equals to, you will get 8.8 kg. Remember, we only substitute kgs, not percentages. 8.8 kg. Then you will take that kg and substitute it in the formula. And for dry matter excreted as well, you need to convert that 77% to say 77 divided by 100 multiplied by 3.5 is equals to 2.7. That is your dry matter in kgs. And then you will take those answers and substitute them in the formula of digestibility coefficient. Then a mark for a formula, a mark for conversion, another mark for conversion, and then a mark for substitution. Right, after calculating, your answer should be in percentages, 69.32. percent. That mark, or that answer is a mark. A unit is another mark. Meaning, if you don't even understand, or even if you don't understand how to calculate, the unit and the formula will give you 2 marks for digestibility coefficient. So you must know the formula, and you must put in the unit when calculating. Even if your answer is incorrect, units must be there, of which is percentage or percentages. And also 3.2, explain the implication of the value calculated in question 3.1. Now, the implication, how much was digested and how much was absorbed by an animal? So this animal digested 69.32% and excreted less than 30%, or 29.7% was excreted. That is your implication. 69.32 was digested and absorbed, or 29.7 was excreted. This is how you provide implication when it comes to digestibility coefficient. Now, also, energy values. You must understand that we are dealing with the four energies, and not every energy that is digested and absorbed goes towards growth, production, and reproduction. Now, the first energy, when it comes to energy values, gross energy, digestible energy, metabolic energy, as well as the metabolic energy. You should know how to calculate these energies. And the units are very important. Energies are calculated in joules, kilojoules, or megajoules. Joules, kilojoules, or megajoules. Now, gross energy. The energy available after the feed has been completely oxidized or burned out. It is a stored energy. It is available. There is no formula for calculating gross energy. Why? Because it is stored in a feed. It is still available. It hasn't undergone digestion. But digestible energy has to be calculated. How do we calculate digestible energy? Digestible energy is equals to gross energy minus energy lost in feces, not just feces, but energy lost in feces. Number two, metabolic energy is equals to digestible energy minus energy lost in urine plus gases, of which is methane. Lastly, net energy. Energy or metabolic energy minus heat increment. And energy is the only energy that is available for farm animals, necessary for growth, production, reproduction, maintenance, and fattening. And also you should be able to identify, or you should be able to state why calculating energy values is important to formulate the ration, determine the feeding standards. You should know all those answers. Right, another calculation, the nutritive ratio. A ratio between digestible non-protein nutrients and digestible nutrients, or digestible protein, I'm sorry. A ratio between digestible non-protein nutrients and digestible protein. And this is the formula. An R on nutritive ratio is equals to 1. 1 is 2 percentage of digestible non-protein nutrients divided by the percentage of digestible protein. Now, every time when writing or calculating, it is very important to say is equals to 1 da. You need to indicate that it is a ratio, and then you must, and then you can continue calculating. And even your answer, 1 is 2. 1 is 2. And this nutritive ratio has no units. Now, if you are done calculating, you need to analyze, you need to interpret the results. Now, let us look at this activity. Now, a cow was given a feed with a total digestible nutrient value of 75% and a digestible protein value of 20%. Calculate the following. The percentage of digestible non-nitrogenous substances of this feed. Right? Remember we said in the formula, we have the non-protein nutrients. Proteins that does not contain, or the nutrients that do not contain nitrogen or protein are fats and carbohydrates. Meaning from the TDN, the total digestible nutrients, you need to subtract, you need to take out protein and be left with the energy-rich nutrients, being carbohydrates and fats. Meaning from that 75, you will say 75 minus 20. Of digestible protein is equals to 55%. Units are very important. So this 55% is your digestible non-nitrogenous substances. They do not contain nitrogen. Right, another question. Calculate the nutritive ratio of this feed. Firstly, you must write the formula, right? And then you must substitute. An R is equals to 1 is 2, 75 minus 20 divided by 20. Why 75 minus 20? You need to take out digestible protein because digestible non-nitrogen substances do not contain nitrogen, right? Divided by 20%. And your answer will be 1 is 2, 3, if we round off to the nearest decimal place, right? And then analyze the result, interpret the result. If your answer is above 1 is to 6, you will say the nutritive ratio is wide. It has more carbohydrates and fats. It is necessary for maintenance and fitting. If your answer is below 1:6, you will say the nutritive ratio is narrow, meaning it has more protein than carbohydrates and fats. It is necessary for growth, production, and reproduction. This is how you interpret nutritive ratio results. Another calculation, the Pearson square. Pearson square is different from the nutritive ratio. Why? Because we are mixing different feeds to get a desired nutrient or a nutrient or a feed that is protein rich. Now here you are mixing different feed to formulate a ration that will be protein rich. Firstly, when formulating, you must know the animal's requirement. Now, firstly, we have the animal's requirement, of which is 17%. This 17% must be at the center of your square or of the Pearson square, and that is your requirement. Secondly, one of the feeds will be protein rich and one feed will be energy rich. A feed that has the lowest percentage is a feed that is energy rich, and a feed that has the highest percentage is the feed that is protein rich. Meaning here, the peanut oil cake is protein rich and this one is energy rich. Maize is energy rich. Meaning when a feed is energy rich, it will have the lowest percentage of protein, right? Meaning level of protein will be low. Meaning maize is energy rich with the lowest percentage of protein. Now, these two percentages, right? The percentage of maize, let me just write M, you write maize, 9% will be written on your left side of the answer sheet or of the Pearson square. And then you have your P representing the peanut oil cake. You can just write peanut oil cake in full. Right, you have 44%. Remember, you are formulating a ration. Why? Because you want to meet the animal's requirement. Now, after writing these, what is next? What follows? Right, you can just say the animal requirement minus 9 and 17 minus 9. And the answer will be, I think it will be 8. Right, you can't just write percentage, but on your right, you write part. And this 8 part no longer belongs to the maize meal, but it now belongs to the peanut oil cake meal. Right, again, 17 minus 44. 17 minus 44. And the answer will be 27. Parts. And this part doesn't belong to peanut. It now belongs to the maize meal. So when you are given, let's just say in the exam, you were provided with a Pearson square with values and parts. Just know the nutrient with the highest part is energy rich, with the lowest percentage of protein. The nutrient with the lowest part is protein rich, that has the highest protein or the highest percentage of protein. Now, after, you should be able to give the ratio, right? Ratio, you don't use the percentages, but instead you only focus on the parts. Now, the ratio, you can just say 27:8. Now, 27 of maize is 8 of peanut oil cake meal. When it comes to calculating the percentage, let's just say calculate the percentage of maize. You can just say 27 divided by the total of parts multiplied by 100. You will be able to get the percentage. But for the ratio, this is how you write the ratio. And you must indicate the part that represents maize and a part that represents the peanut oil cake meal. Now, the last calculation for nutrition or animal nutrition will be your fodder flow program. A plan for livestock farmers to ensure that there is availability of feed for animals throughout the year. So here, basically, when it comes to fodder flow program, we are meeting the animals' requirements. We are making sure that there is availability of feed throughout the year, every season, whether dry season or rainy season. So when it comes to fodder flow program, this is how you should attempt answering these questions. Number one, you should understand that during dry season, there is always a shortage of feed. Always a shortage of feed. Remember, we are only dealing with fodder. We are only dealing with roughages consumed by ruminants. So there will always be a shortage during winter season. Meaning during dry season, we need to supplement or we need to apply kelling where we remove the unproductive farm animals. Right? During rainy season, we always experience the surplus. Why? Because the environment or the conditions, they favor roughages or the growth or development of roughages of fodder. Why? Because there's high rainfall and there is high temperature. Now, during rainy season, we always experience surplus, meaning we always experience having more than enough. Meaning, to reduce the costs on fodder flow program, we need to store feed during rainy season for dry season. So here again, you should be able to compare, right? Understand the feed requirements of farm animals. Let's just say you have 50 farm animals. And these 50 farm animals, they require a feed weighing 3.5 or 3,500. And the land that you have or availability of feed only gives you 2,100 kg of feed, then you will know you have a shortage. Why? Feed requirement is greater than the feed availability. So you should be able to calculate the feed availability. You should be able to calculate the feed requirement and be able to compare whether or be able to come to conclusion whether you have a shortage or a surplus. When there is a surplus, what do? You store. And surplus, we normally experience a surplus during rainy season due to environment or due to conditions. Conditions are favorable. They favor roughages. They favor fodder. And also, when calculating for a flow program, you should know that the weight of feed is calculated using two units, kgs as well as tons. So to move from tons to kgs, you multiply by 1,000. To move from kgs to tons, you divide by 1,000 because tons are greater than kgs. So this is what you should know. And then you should also be able to know the principles and the importance of fodder flow program. Why fodder flow program is important? It is important because it ensures the availability of feed the availability of feed for animals throughout the year, meaning we are meeting the animals' requirements. Secondly, it ensures the safe use of natural resources. It is cost efficient. Why is it cost efficient? Because when we are experiencing surplus, We store for dry season, meaning we minimize the cost that we spend on supplements. Why? Because supplements are very expensive. So basically, this is your fodder flow program. So on today's lesson, we just unpacked on how to answer section A, question one, as well as your question two. Section A, that is question one, multiple choice out of 20 marks. Column A and B, 10 marks. Give one term, 10 marks. You correct the underlined, 5 marks. In total, section A, 45 marks. Question two, your animal nutrition. Study of how nutrients are digested. Out of 35 marks. So we discussed more about the different types of farm animals, ruminants and non-ruminants, the different digestive system or alimentary canals, and their organs, right? Different types of digestion, types of feed, concentrates, roughages, components of feed, dry matter, and moisture content, functions of water, very important, right? Nutrients, proteins, carbohydrates, fats, vitamins that are fat soluble, vitamins that are water soluble, minerals having macro minerals and micro minerals, understanding the functions and the nutrient deficiencies of each nutrient, and we also focused more on calculations, digestibility coefficient, energy values, nutritive ratio, pacing square, as well as the fodder flow program. Right, on our next lesson, we'll be focusing on your question two, of which is your animal production control or production control and diseases. That is out of 35 marks again. Right, we'll be discussing more about the different types of farming systems, right, different production systems, different shelter used, right, animal behavior, different handling facilities, transportation, animal diseases, animal parasites, as well as animal metallic poisoning and plant poisoning, as they mainly affect the health of farm animals. Right, thank you for watching this lesson. See you next time. Goodbye. Have a lovely day.